Today's wrestling crowds can be a bit tiresome, in large part due to the need of many fans to demonstrate just how smart they are. Yes, we get it, you think Roman Reigns is overrated. Yes, we know you don't like this match, and that's why you're chanting for CM Punk. Sure, you get to chant "You deserve it" at new champions because you alone deem who is worthy of carrying gold. Congratulations, you think this show sucks, and that's why you dropped good money on a floor-level ticket. It all makes one pine for the days of less savvy fans. You know, the grannies that sat front row at Memphis events and spat at the heels. The kids who buy into it all being real, and the easily worked up true believers that would just as soon jump the guardrail to get at the bad guys. Admittedly, that is the argument for smartening up the crowds. Jim Cornette can speak lovingly of those days of near riots and knife-wielding spectators, and those tales do have their incredulous charms, but it's probably for the best that attempts on a wrestler's life have become extremely scarce. We here at Cultaholic give you this look back at times when fans attempted to kill the sneering fiends that gleefully beat upon their heroes when wrestling got a little too real. I'm Adam Pacitti from Cultaholic.com, and this is 10 times fans tried to kill wrestlers. Join us! Number 10, Blackjack Mulligan. Mulligan provides the roots of a very interesting wrestling family tree. He is the father of Barry and Kendall Windham, father-in-law of Mike Rotunda, and the grandfather of both Bo Dallas and Bray Wyatt. That group alone is a pretty tough collection of heavyweight maulers, with Mulligan himself being the baddest of the bunch. Standing roughly 6'8" tall and weighing over 300 pounds, the brawny, mustachioed Mulligan could convincingly stand toe-to-toe with leviathans like Andre the Giant. The reviled black-hatted cowboy was due to face WWWF champion Pedro Morales inside Boston Garden one night in May 1971, when he was suddenly faced with a challenge more daunting than the cagey Morales. A knife-wielding fan jumped the guardrail and stabbed Mulligan in the thigh, instantly drawing a river of blood. Kayfabe went out the window when babyface Gorilla Monsoon raced towards the ring to apprehend the assailant. The Boston Globe recounted the evening as towels applied to Mulligan's wound instantly turned red. His wound would need more than 100 stitches to sew shut. Number 9, Classy Freddie Blassie. If there was ever a wrestling legend that reveled in notoriety, it was the Hollywood fashion plate himself. Although Blassie in later years would become warmly revered as something of a grandfatherly figure, he was an ace heel in his active wrestling days, even going as far to file his own teeth into vampiric points, which he would then use for biting his foes. Now that's dedication to greatness. Just as dedicated fans were loathing Blassie for his evil, underhanded ways, years later Blassie would almost wistfully recall his brushes with near death, which included fans stabbing him and an instant in which his car was set on fire. But perhaps the most unique assault on Blassie came in a WWA Championship defense against Lord Jane Bleers in the early 60s. As Blassie headed toward the ring, a couple of teenagers threw acid at him, splashing his back. Blassie didn't realize it was acid until he was inside the ring, and his flesh began to burn. Blassie claims that Bleers threw up from the odor. Freddie sought immediate attention backstage, effectively cancelling the bout, although he did return to the ring 3 nights later. Number 8, Nature Boy Paul Lee. We said that it's much rarer for fans to go all helter-skelter on wrestlers this day and age, but that doesn't mean it never happens. Take an American Wrestling Federation event in Ringgold, Georgia, that took place in June 2016. It was there that veteran heel Paul Lee found himself in a rather unexpected situation. While assaulting his rope-tied opponent with a chair, somebody came to the defense of the babyface, and it wasn't another wrestler. A 59-year-old spectator named Patricia Ann Crow climbed into the ring, pulling a handgun on Lee. Lee acknowledged that earlier in the match he'd done what many heels have done, and that's taunt the fans, in particular Crow. Lee claims that he told Crow to sit her toothless self back down, and it was then she approached the ring with her loaded pistol in front of more than 150 witnesses. Incredibly, Crow was released on $4,000 bail 2 days later. As a result of the incident, the promotion was considering installing a metal detector at their monthly events. Number 7, Brian Knobbs. It's unclear if the assailants in this incident were actually fans, but there's a good chance that they knew exactly who Knobbs was when they went after him. 2 weeks before the 1992 Royal Rumble, Knobbs, partner Jerry Sags, and Irwin R. Scheister had departed from a house show in Peoria, Illinois, when they were followed by a group of four youths in another vehicle. Knobbs would end up being pulled from the Rumble pay-per-view as a result of the ensuing attack. Knobbs later testified testified in court that the car swerved over several lanes of traffic to cut the wrestler's vehicle off. One of the youths, a 20-year-old named David Miller, apparently stabbed Knobs in the chest with a knife after the wrestlers exited his car to check for damage. It was also claimed that 19-year-old Chad Reigns attacked Sags with jumper cables during the melee. A 16-year-old girl who was with the attackers would testify in court that Miller had indeed used the knife on Knobs. Incredibly, Knobs was back in action at the TV tapings 1 week following the Rumble, and 3 weeks after the attack. Number 6. Jesse the Body Ventura. The showy and charismatic Ventura knows how to find the right verbiage to get under people's skin with. His gift of the gab would serve him well as an actor, and later a seminal figure in politics. But as a pro wrestling heel, Ventura used his confident cocksure delivery especially for drawing heat. Ventura learned one night in Eugene, Oregon, just how much trouble his mouth could get him into. After one of Ventura's matches, there was a fight at ringside, and the police on hand went to intervene, leaving Ventura alone to walk to the locker room. Just before the body made it to the curtain, a 16-year-old kid emerged from behind the bleachers, whom Ventura had described as white with rage. Ventura believes he may have insulted him earlier in the match, and this kid was now armed with a hunting knife that boasted a 10-inch blade. The teenager reportedly said, "Ventura, I'm gonna stick this up your ass." Even with his Navy SEAL training, Ventura couldn't envision a scenario where he could subdue the kid without leaving himself open to be seriously hurt. Fortunately, a plainclothes officer happened to be in the crowd, saw what was happening, and managed to sneak up on the kid before anything regrettable could happen. Number 5. Ole Anderson. One of the founding four horsemen, Ole Anderson may well have been the all-time toughest member of a group that's had its fair share of roughnecks, including Arn Anderson, Barry Windham, and even a Pro Bowl defensive lineman in Steve McMichael. Anderson's grit was put to the test one night in Greenville, South Carolina in 1976, after he and kayfabe brother Gene had just concluded an NWA World Tag Team title bout. As the Andersons made their way up the aisle, an elderly fan named Oscar Ramsey, listed by some sources as being 82 years old at the time, stabbed Ole in the arm and chest with a hawkbill knife, a utility blade that has a very pronounced curve. Anderson was taken to a local hospital, where he would undergo 4 hours of surgery to repair torn tendons in his arm, and receive dozens of stitches to the multiple wounds in his arm and torso. To demonstrate Ole Anderson's toughness, he was back at work 2 nights later for a Mid-Atlantic Wrestling TV tapings. Number 4. Jim Cornette. Well, you know Corny had to be in here somewhere. You don't romanticize the territory days of wrestling like Jim Cornette does without having at least one good "and that's how my life was nearly compromised" campfire tale. The Louisville Lip is chock full of incredible tales, and indeed he recalls a time in Houma, Louisiana, in which he and Midnight Expresser Dennis Condrey ran afoul of a dozen Cajun fans that, in Cornette's words, had decided they didn't like the Midnight Express. The parking lot skirmish was escalated by Condrey telling off the lead drunk among the pack. Said drunk fan flung an unopened beer at Condrey, missed him, and ended up getting taken down hard to the ground, where lover boy Dennis kicked him in the face. The other 11 rowdies were prepared to intervene, and Cornette, armed with his tennis racket, knew the odds were not in he and Condrey's favor. Before it could get uglier, the Rock and Roll Express drove their car toward the mob, sending the mob scurrying away and allowing their on-screen nemesis a chance to get into the car and flee into the night. Number 3. Bobby the Brain Heenan. Given the caliber of villain that has already graced this list, it should come as no surprise that pro wrestling's preeminent manager had at least one notable attempt on his life. Fans of WWE in the latter half of the 1980s were more prone to innocently chanting "weasel" as a means of getting at Heenan. If only life in the AWA were that simple for the Brain. In January 1975, at Chicago's International Amphitheater, Heenan was backing his main charge Nick Bockwinkel for a match against champion Vern Gagne, and naturally Heenan took to interfering. This enraged one particular fan, who produced a gun and began firing at the manager. Heenan managed to avoid the bullets, but a reported 5 ringside fans were injured, one of them critically. Heenan recalled hearing the attacker say just prior to the shots, "Don't worry, I'll get him down." Bockwinkel remembers fans rushing over to aid one of the fans, a woman who was struck in the shoulder. Incredibly, the fan was never arrested, and reportedly kept attending shows after that, which is, well, insane. Number 2. Rowdy Roddy Piper. Another name you'd expect on such a list is that of the Hot Rod, who thoroughly enjoyed being a villainous heat magnet at many points in his career. Few wrestlers could whip crowds into the heated frenzy that Piper could, and even fewer were willing to cross the boundary lines needed to earn such murderous scorn. But Piper breached many lines in his career, and sometimes paid the price for it. Piper has claimed to have been stabbed a total of 3 times in his career, and says that the worst such incident occurred in Raleigh, North Carolina in the early 80s. 80s. Outside the actual arena, a knife-wielding fan was menacing Piper from a distance, getting Roddy's attention. Piper went to grab a pole to defend himself, but when he temporarily took his eyes off the blade, the fan lurched forth and plunged the knife into Piper's torso, reportedly coming within an inch of Piper's heart. Piper remembers the police subduing the attacker, and one cop was fixing to shoot him in the back of the head during the struggle, only for the sergeant to physically prevent his fellow officer from firing. Piper would call it the closest he's ever been to seeing somebody be shot. Number 1. The Freebirds. The trio of Michael Hayes, Terry Gordy, and Buddy Roberts were perhaps best known for their countless run-ins with the wildly popular Von Erich family in World Class throughout the 1980s. While fans in Dallas certainly wanted to kill the free-spirited rebels, it was in Bill Watts' Mid-South that one fan almost did the Freebirds in. After the Freebirds defeated the Junkyard Dog and Buck Robley in a tag team title match one night, a post-match skirmish ended with Hayes throwing hair remover cream into Junkyard Dog's eyes, kayfabe blinding him. JYD was immensely popular to Mid-South fans, and the angle put incredible heat on the Freebirds. To make matters worse, a still-blind Junkyard Dog lamented that he may never get to see his recently born daughter as a result of what the Freebirds did to him. The angle came to a head one night in New Orleans when Dog sat in the corner for a group of babyfaces in a match with the Freebirds, sitting in a chair with his cane and sunglasses. Hayes had taken to mocking his blinded nemesis when an irate fan jumped the rail, crouched next to Dog, says, "Don't worry, Dog, I got him," and pointed a pistol at the Freebirds. This provided a rather darkly comical situation, as JYD, who actually could see the gun, was sworn to kayfabe, so does he keep pretending to be blind and do nothing, or does he stop the shooter and save the Freebirds while exposing the business and risk having kayfabe adherent Bill Watts attempt to kill him later? Fortunately, the police tackled the gunman seconds later before any shots were fired, lives were spared, and perhaps more importantly to Watts, the angle remained untarnished. So that's our list. Let us know what you think in the comments below, and you can follow me on Twitter here. If you enjoy what we do here at Cultaholic, you can pledge to our Patreon. That's patreon.com/cultaholic. And most importantly, don't forget to hit subscribe and join us.